morning.
Welcome. Beautiful day. Are there any announcements from the pews? Yes, Audrey.
Next week I will have an order form for poinsettias. They will be $6 for anybody who would like to put a poinsettia in honor or memory someone on the altar for Christmas.
Yes, Lana.
You've been praying for Jackie Milling, and we haven't done this in a long, long time since before COVID, but I'm going to pass, this is a prayer shawl, and I'm going to pass this over to AK Glenn, and what I'd like you to do is say a prayer and pass it on, and we will give it to Jackie.
Announcements from here. If you have not stimulated the economy for Christmas enough yet, you know that the craft fair is still going on. It'll be downstairs will be open up at any time here today, and of course the rest of Hope is still the craft fair. Also, this coming Saturday is the Hope Lantern Tour. If you have never seen Hope lit up with luminaries, it is gorgeous. And there's a historic tour that you can take. But it ends here at St. John's, and we'll have our Moravian candlelight service. So that will start at 7:30 p.m. So feel free to go to both, come to just the service, whichever you'd like. And I think that's it. And right now we are planning on Wednesday night, December 21st, to be caroling in the center of town at 7 p.m. If you care to come. Just, you know, sing a bunch of Christmas carols, nothing more, just a lot, just to have fun during the Christmas season. So that will be December 21st. And we will be having our barn service this year at Terry Urquhart Barn at 7:30 p.m. on Christmas Eve. We don't have any service in the church that night. That is our service. So if you don't know where that is, that's on Jenny Jump Road. As you turn into the road, it's the first barn on the right-hand side. You can't miss it. You'll have it decked out, as always. So that's our Christmas Eve service. And we will be here for Christmas morning, which is a Sunday, where we will be singing carols and that kind of fun stuff for Christmas Day. So, okay. I think that's it. Can't guarantee it. But let's go on. Let's stand and sing number 2092, Like a Child.
Today, we light the candle of hope. We anticipate Christ incarnate, Jesus among us, who will guide us in every aspect of our lives, even in the most hopeless of places. We light this candle to declare that we expect hope to show up. As we add hope to our journey, we remember that Christ is coming.
Let us pray. Holy God, we confess that we are not always the most hopeful people, and that we often find ourselves wanting to give up hope in this life. Please, Lord, remind us of your ever-present hope, and that you are always with us, even in hopeless spaces. Remind us
worship where we raise before God and one another our joys, our cares, our concerns. So I would ask, are there any prayer requests this morning? Yes, Lois.
Well, that's a real joy. God willing, the closing is scheduled for Tuesday. So if nothing else goes wrong, and my dog found us too, we're by the end of the week. He's kind of a dog that all the other mother can love, you know, the face and the mismatched ears and everything else. Like each body part belongs to a different breed. But yeah, he's real sweet. He's a therapy dog, and he was just.
Oh, what's his name?
Miles.
Miles.
And Luna will come home. It's Joy. The kitty.
Yeah, prayers for my mom, who's not feeling well. She's up there by herself in New York, and, well, she's just not feeling well.
Yes,
I have the joy that my niece Kelly is here with worshiping today, and we spent yesterday together. She's one of the vendors, and listened to me welcoming people to St. John's.
We're crafty.
It's genetic, huh?
Yesterday I got to have some fun yesterday morning. Pastor Carla took me to what I call the Lego extravaganza in Secaucus. So we got to play with Legos for a few hours. It was a lot of fun.
It's amazing what some people can do with Lego. And have you ever seen the show Lego Masters? After we attempted to build a robot this big, I have so much more appreciation.
With help.
With help, yes.
Yes, I'm thankful for our secret angel gifts for our children, and I know they're going to enjoy them, and I think that's wonderful that you all help me out with that.
Of course. Yes, Jean.
Continued prayers for Robbie and for Ruby.
Linda, do you have that?
Yes.
I wanted to pray for the church musicians at this time of the year. It's a busy time. Lots of music to learn. We're in the middle of the night, all hoping that I'm going to do a good job. And, you know, just that there would be ministry through the carols. And, you know, it's a good time for people to hear the gospel.
Absolutely. So. Mm-hmm. Yes, I woke up 4 o'clock yesterday morning with that listening ear.
Ruminating is the word?
Yeah.
Yes, Marianne.
First for Jackie.
Yes, Audrey.
I have a couple of joys, but Michael and Jennifer have got a CO for their house and they'll be moving next Friday. They're thrilled. And I had the most wonderful surprise this morning. Johnny Rocco shows up and says, I've got something to show you. And outside he had bought a tractor from us, and he refurbished it. It was a farm old tractor. And he had it up here, and I got a picture with him, and it was Tom's tractor. And might have been even my father's, I don't know for sure. But anyway, it's running, and he's going to have it down someplace in town with lights on it and everything. So it was really a joy to see that.
I have one for one of the Facebook pages I'm on. It's for pastors. It's called Things They Didn't Teach Us in Seminary. And somebody had posted yesterday, the church is St. Andrew's in Harlem. I'm not sure what denomination. It really doesn't matter. It was vandalized. It was broken into just this week. They broke in and stole all the organ pipes to get scrap metal money for them, and also anything they could carry, the candles, you know, whatever. And yes, it's just a building, and yes, the people are the church, but this is their sacred space. And it's just a feeling of violation, and during this most festive season, it hurt. So, prayers for St. Andrews. Let us pray. Gracious Almighty, ever-living God, we are here, Lord,
to wait for your coming once again, Emmanuel, God with us. But we also know that you are here, and you will always be here, and we are grateful. We are here to give our thanks, we are here to give our praise, we are here to give our hearts, our spirits, our minds, our lives to you, this day and always. And it's only one way that we can know how to say thank you, Lord. For we know and acknowledge that you are God of all creation and Lord of our lives, and that you put the planets in their place, and yet you know us each by name. And we are so blessed and grateful for that. And this morning, we are here to say thank you and to give you that praise and honor you so deserve. And Lord, as we come with cares and concerns and joys on our hearts that we place on your altar and that we celebrate with you. We celebrate the lowest and keep praying that the closing, well, nothing else will inhibit it, that it will happen on Tuesday and that all will go well and they will have a new home for family. And may they be blessed richly in the days and weeks ahead in it. And for the dog that found them, as she puts it, Lord, for Miles, you somehow bring the right creations together. And they are grateful for Miles as well. So thank you, Lord, for blessing them so richly. And Lord, we pray for Corona, for Larry's mom. Just place your healing hand on her and may she return to fullness and wholeness of health soon in the days ahead, that she too can enjoy the holiday season that's coming up. And we celebrate with Audrey and having Kelly here with us. Just so much joy in sharing the holidays with family and being together and all the memories they make and all the joy it brings. So thank you for that blessing. And we celebrate Larry and just being able to get out yesterday and just enjoy the day, things that are just so much fun to do. And with Peggy, I'm grateful, Lord, for all the generous hearts in this congregation that give of themselves and become secret angels this time of year to make a family in need's Christmas all the more special. So thank you for touching hearts and blessing hearts. And may all that who receive these gifts feel your presence and your love through them. And may they truly celebrate the reason for the season. Lord, we continue our prayers for Augie, that little baby who is has cancer. We thank you for the progress he has made, and we just continue to pray that he will be rid of his cancer as quickly as possible and with a long, healthy, and happy life. And for Nikki Smith, Lord, who is also going through so much with cancer, we pray your healing touch on him as well, and may he return to fullness and wholeness of health. And Lord, in this season, there is so much going on to praise you and to give whole hearts to you, especially through church musicians. So we ask your blessing on each church musician everywhere as they prepare so much music just to celebrate your birth, to bring joy and spirit into this season. Give each one the strength that they need and the patience to learn. Lord, we continue our prayers for Jackie as she struggles with cancer. Be with her, keep her strong, help rid her body of this cancer, and may she return also to fullness of health. May she continue to feel your presence, be at peace, and trust in you. And Lord, we just celebrate with Mike and Jen that they finally can move into their new house, this dream house that they have had planned for so long, and has come to fruition, and we just thank you for the blessings that made it possible, and all that went into it. So continue to watch over them and bless them as they enter into their new house. And for John, who took to heart a refurbished tractor, it doesn't seem like much, but it is so much, because it just shows the love of history and the respect of history and the people and the caring in this community. So thank you for that blessing as well. And Lord, we pray for the community, the congregation of St. Andrew's, who was violated this week. Yes, it's just a building. People are the church. May your spirit remind them of that. They don't need the frills. They don't need the organ. They don't need the pretty candlestick holders. They need you, and only you. So may they be extra blessed this season by being reminded of this and of your presence with them. Lord, there are those who are worshiping with us from their kitchens and from their couches who also have cares and concerns that they place on your altar.
Lord, for those who have been named who need your healing touch, we ask you as our great physician to guide the doctors, caring for them, to place your healing hand on them, and return all to fullness and wholeness of health. For those who may have been named who are grieving at this time, we pray that your spirit will bring them comfort and peace. And for those who have just celebrated a joyful event in life, we thank you for being there, blessing it, making it all the more joyful. And as always, Lord, we pray for this world, where there is war, let there be peace, where there's depression, let there be freedom, where there's hunger, may they be fed, where there's illness, may they be healed. Through us, through others, may this world come to know the peace and the kingdom you have promised. Through Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, yours will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our first reading today is from Isaiah 40. And he wrote, "Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her hard service has been completed, that her sin has been paid for, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice of one crying, calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up and every mountain and hill made low. The rough ground shall be made, become level, and the rugged places be plain. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all the people will see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken." And our next reading is from the Malachi, 3rd chapter. And he wrote, "I will send my messenger, who will prepare the way before me. Then suddenly the Lord you are seeking will come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant whom you desire will come, says the Lord Almighty. But who can endure the day of his coming? Who can stand when he appears? For he will be like a refiner's fire or a launderer's soap. He will be as a refiner and purifier of silver. He will purify the Levites and refine them like gold and silver. Then the Lord will have men who will bring offerings in righteousness, and the offerings of Judah and Jerusalem will be acceptable to the Lord, as in days gone by, as in former years." And now you will stand, and we will sing number 206, "I Want to Walk as a Child of the Light."
Thank you.
news about Jesus the Messiah, the Son of God, as it was written in Isaiah the prophet. I will send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way, a voice of one calling in the wilderness. Prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight paths for him. And so John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. The whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him, confessing their sins. They were baptized by him in the Jordan River. John wore clothing made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist. And he ate locusts and wild honey. And this was his message. After me comes the one more powerful than I, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. So, here we go again. Here we go, for the 4 weeks before Christmas, trying to pretend that Jesus has never come before. And we don't know this. Why do we do this? When all of us have probably heard this Jesus story every year since the year of our birth, we know he's come. Why do we always repeat it every year? Well, one commentator put it this way. Advent is a lot like waiting for pictures to be developed. And AK, I know that might be a little confusing. I don't think you've ever seen a roll of film and had to bring it to Acme and get it developed and wait a whole week so you can come back and see what pictures you got. But for the rest of you, you're all old enough to know what we're talking about. It's about opening a freshly developed set of pictures and allowing the past and the future to amaze us and bring it back to the present again. I brought in a gift today that Larry and I just received a few weeks back. It's the photo album for our son and daughter-in-law's wedding, which was September of 2019. And they will admit, partly it was their fault. It took forever to get through the pictures. Partly was the pandemic. And partly was the company they used took forever to get these things put together. But you can imagine opening up this photo album and all the warm and fuzzies coming back. You know, all the good times. It was just a wonderful day and all the memories that just flooded back. And I'm assuming all of you have had that same kind of experience when you look at old pictures or see an old picture. This commentator is trying to get us to think about hearing the story of Jesus kind of in that same way of looking at pictures from the past. He wrote, Advent isn't a time of pretending that Jesus was never been born. It's a time of preparing for what that birth might mean for us today. It's not a denial, but it's a dark room, a chance to follow the fullness of God's love to develop in our lives and to be revealed in glorious technicolor. I love that word that the commentator used. And what it brought to my mind is, you have to understand, last Christmas Eve, our son and daughter-in-law were at the house. They had dinner with us, but they didn't come to church. They didn't come to the barn service. They didn't go to Walnut Valley. But Pastor Mama put that aside. They were at least home. And when we got back to home, I thought we had a nice sized TV. Well, our son thought we needed a bigger one. And now we've got this, I call it our theater room. And so we've been enjoying it, no denying that. And this week, Larry and I put on one of our favorite Christmas videos, The Bishop's Wife. You know, the old one with Cary Grant and David Niven's and all that good stuff. And oh my gosh, on this big new screen, we were catching little subtle things that we had never seen before on a smaller TV. That's kind of how we need to approach Advent. To be open, to be looking for little nuances, to try to hear it fresh and new, and and just wallow in it like you enjoy looking at old pictures. Think of that story in that way. And so this year we start in the Gospel of Mark, which is kind of an odd gospel to be using in Advent, because if you noticed, there is no birth story. The reading I gave you was chapter 1, verse 1. Mark starts off with John the Baptist and Jesus' baptism, right out of the gate. There is no Joseph being the good guy, considering to marry Mary, like he does in Matthew. There's no Mary being so obedient and saying, oh, your will, I am your maiden, do what you will. No, not in Mark. Mark is like a starting pistol going off. And it begins with the beginning of the good news about Jesus the Messiah, the Son of God. And off he goes. One commentator called this, it's about an invasion. An invasion by God into humanity. Now, they had been waiting for one. As you heard Malachi, he promised that someone would come. They were waiting for him, but they weren't crying out for God. They were patiently waiting for over 400 years for the Messiah to come. And here without, at least it's not in Scripture, to tell us people weren't crying out to God, that life was so miserable, or crying out to God for anything else. God just showed up. And he calls it an invasion. And because of this, Mark's gospel emphasizes God's salvation coming to earth more than anything else. Each gospel has its own unique focus. This is Mark's. And it starts right at the beginning. And as the commentator put, he goes, this is a story of God who will bring his reign, come hell or high water. Ready or not, here God comes. And with that, Mark also gives us some direction, some prayer. He actually quotes Isaiah and Malachi, if you caught the readings, but although in Mark it only talks about Isaiah. And in those two separate prophets, they use the word prepare. And what's important to realize is in English, in the Greek, those two words are different. We translate it the same, but they're different in the Greek. The first word for prepare, now, if you really need to know this, come see me later, because there is no way I can pronounce these words. Trust me. But if you want it, I can show it. The first prepare is the way of the Lord, deals with an internal preparation. It also means to construct or create or furnish. But its main focus is about an internal preparation, about becoming vessels or receptacles of God's love, compassion, and grace. So if you want to hear that as a command, because it sounds that way in the gospel, prepare the way for the Lord, it's like saying, make yourself ready to be a vessel through which God's love can enter into history. That's why we are here, to remind ourselves again that God uses us, works through each and every one of us. And that is why we prepare for Advent. It's a good time to reflect and remember that. Now the second prepare, again, you really need to see it, come up here afterwards. This has a sense of to get ready for a big event. This is an external prepare. It's used in all three Gospels when Jesus tells the disciples to go prepare a room for the Last Supper. It's that kind of planning ahead and doing something to get ready for. So this is, you know, what do we do externally to prepare for Christ's birth and Christ's coming and the celebration of Christmas? So between these two prepares, it's internal and external, and it's to remind us of God's presence. Now, one other word that is in the Mark passage that loses in translation in the English is a little word, way, to prepare the way of the Lord. In the Greek, the word is podos. That one I can pronounce. It is defined as how one walks. And I like that, how one walks. The early disciples didn't call themselves Christians after Jesus they call themselves belonging to or followers of the way. They walked to the best of their ability the way Jesus walked. And this, I hope, gets you thinking of how do you walk? How closely to the way of Jesus do you walk? And how do you prepare for that walking? How straight is your path to Christ? In the busyness of this season, it's easy, so easy, to get distracted from the way, from focusing on Jesus, who is still leading the way. It's so easy to say, oh my gosh, I forgot, I've got to get a present for this time. Oh, I got to get a present for them. Oh, darn, I got to get the Christmas tree up. I got to get the lights going. Oh, so-and-so bought me such a nice present last year, and I gave him a little tchotchke, and oh, I got to do better this year. What am I going to do? On and on. This season can go in your brain if you let it and distract you from the true reason and spirit of the season, the season of compassion and giving and caring. How do you walk, and how are you preparing for Christ? Mark is an interesting gospel. It's a fast-moving gospel, like I said at the beginning, but at the end, it's so ambiguous. If you use the oldest of texts that we have, the women at the Easter tomb run away frightened and don't ever tell anybody about Jesus being alive and risen. It just ends that he's not here. If you look at your Bibles, most other will then add in brackets stating, not an original text, about how they went and told the disciples, and so the good news got spread. But if we actually follow the original text, Mark's gospel would end with nobody ever hearing about Jesus being resurrected and the good news of that. So how, according to Mark's gospel, did we ever get here today with the good news? Well, that's back to that invasion that I talked about in the beginning. It was an invasion by God without an invitation, without any need for receptivity. It was just God was coming, and he wasn't going to stop it. Nothing would stop it. And so we are here today because of that invasion. One commentator wrote this: now let us know how the good news begins. With an invasion, at God's initiative, the bus has left the station. Get out of the way or get on the way. Yes, get ready. For the good news is still coming. Will you allow yourself to be a part of it? Amen.
into our time of Holy Communion. And as always, I extend Christ's invitation to Christ's table. He is our host, we are his guests, and all are welcome to the table. This is not quite a prayer of confession, but I thought it was an appropriate prayer for Advent. So let us pray together.
Accompany us, God, through the waiting. Accompany those displaced, waiting to return to the land. Accompany those in refugee camps, waiting to go home. Accompany those in conflict zones, waiting for normality. Accompany those in violent homes, waiting for silence. Accompany those in prison, waiting for justice. Accompany us, God, through the waiting, until your kingdom comes. Amen.
Marianne, thank you. Please join me in dedicating our offering.
Living God, we give our offerings to you this day, asking your blessing on them. Bless the givers as well as those who will receive. Surround us with the hope of this Advent season. We pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
You'll find tray Thanksgiving for communion in your bulletin insert on the back page. Let us pray. In the love of God, we have been given life and the world in which to live it. Even as the leaves have turned and fallen away, and the snow will soon be settled and cover the earth, we know the promise of life never ends. As God gives us the Sabbath of winter, we know that spring is being ready.
In creation and Sabbath, God, we give you thanks.
In the grace of Jesus Christ, we have been given new life and a world in which to share. As we anticipate the incarnation, we are reminded once again of Jesus' ministry among us. Preaching and healing, Jesus binds up what is broken, sets free what is bound. Teaching and forgiving, Jesus feeds us on God's word so that we can continue his ministry in the world.
For your welcoming and sending, Jesus, we give you thanks.
In communion of the Holy Spirit, we, the many, become one. Speaking to us through God's word, we hear the message of both repentance and forgiveness. Living and active, the Holy Spirit calms the storms that churn within us, while also calling us to rise up, to give shelter to those struggling in the midst of their own storms.
For your tending, encouraging, Holy Spirit, we give you thanks.
Holy Spirit, we gather once again at the table, wishing to be fed by the Lord. May the loaf and the cup that nourish our bodies also be communion with Christ, nourishing our souls. Unify us that we may take your hope into the world. The only thing that will never fail us is our hope in Jesus, God's love poured into us through the Holy Spirit. This table and meal are proof of that. At this table, we are reminded of the violence of this world. Jesus' body broken and blood shed. But in this broken body and shed blood, the seeds of hope were planted. Hope that blossoms into peace, bearing the fruit of joy and love. We gather and celebrate this meal in remembrance of Jesus, proclaiming our hope in the living Christ until he comes again.
Amen.
The table is set. All are welcome. Just as this is one loaf, we are one body of Christ. All are welcome. May I have a volunteer to serve the cup? Thank you, Lord.
210. All the world, all the earth is waiting. Three verses, thank you, Jen. 1, 2, and 3.
Amen.